Good morning, everyone. We're so glad to have you with us this morning. We're going to begin our worship service by singing several hymns, and then later on in the service, we'll be singing some contemporary music that I hope you'll enjoy as well. Let's stand together, shall we, as we begin our morning with "We Praise Thee, O God, Our Redeemer." Slightly different there. Sometimes our music here and the slides there aren't the same source, and so occasionally there's little glitches that we miss. But our scripture this morning is correct, and it's from Colossians 1, 15 and 16. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. Colossians 1, 15 and 16.
Faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is
Be seated.
Good morning, church. It is so good to be able to praise the Lord, isn't it? Well, last night I was able to take part in a home hospitality group, and there's nothing like fellowship and food, right? It is so good. Good fellowship and good food. And I'm guessing that some of your groups have met together, and I hope that that is going to be or has been a real blessing in your life. So in the spirit of fellowship, why don't we stand and greet each other this morning? Good morning. This is Pastor Brett from Caldwell First Baptist Church on September 23rd. We're so glad you tuned in to our service. And we pray that you are blessed and that Christ meets you with his word this morning. If you do have any questions about our church, please go ahead and contact us. You can find our information on the church website. And if you need any prayer or have any special things you'd like to talk to us about, please don't hesitate to call. Lord bless you. Have a great day. Okay, well, this morning we are going to continue our worship as we read together the verse of the month. So if everyone would go ahead and stand where they were, we're looking at Colossians chapter 1, verses 11 through 12. Okay, would you repeat with me the word of God? May you be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Colossians 1, 11 through 12. You may be seated. Well, if you would take that a pad of paper that's on the outside edge of the pews, and if you're a regular attender, please go ahead and just let us know you were here. Put down your name. If you're new here, we'd love it if you filled out your information. And for everybody, let's go ahead and leave those on the pews. You don't have to put those in the offering plate or take them to the back. We will collect those. It's a great way to communicate with us anything that you would like to. Well, if you're a first-time visitor, we want to welcome you. We're glad you came. We do have a visitor center in the back, and we have a gift for you there and some information about the church. We'd love it if you stopped by. We want to remind everyone that we do have new Sunday school hours, and we want to encourage you to spend some time fellowshipping. We have a great library there with coffee and different foods to be able to enjoy fellowship and all kinds of things going on. Just a good time to be able to talk with other people and get to know people from the church. We also want to let you know that there are new office hours, so go ahead and take a look at your bulletin about which hours those are. Please take note as you're thinking about coming in or coming visiting us or have any kind of needs, those are the times that we'll be open. Well, I am very excited for this next announcement because I've been waiting for this announcement since January. And we are glad to announce that we're starting a new growth group ministry here at the church. Take a look at your bulletin, and in that bulletin, there is this handy-dandy little brochure that says growth groups. And for months and months, we've been working on developing the leaders of these growth groups, training them, and some of these growth groups, three of them actually, have been going on for quite some time, and getting it worked out how we're going to do growth groups here at Caldwell First Baptist Church. Now, as you open up that brochure, there are six reasons of why you want to join a growth group. And so this, just to introduce you to the concept and the idea, I'm going to go ahead and read just the titles of these. The first reason to join a growth group is you'll be able to understand and apply the Bible better in a growth group. What every growth group is doing, there are five of them so far, and we're hoping to increase many more, is that they take questions based off of the sermon and basically flesh it out for applicational type of, you know, ways of using the scripture. So that's going to be something that all the growth groups are doing. They're all doing it together, and there's not a study involved. You basically just come on Sunday, hear the sermon, and then you go discuss it in your growth group. But it takes it a little deeper. Sometimes we do cross-references. Sometimes we go to different areas. Number two, you'll begin to build friendships in God's family. You know, when you come to a church for the first time, or maybe you've been here for quite some time, it can be hard to make relationships. And when you join a growth group, you instantly begin to get know a consistent group of people and to build those relationships on a weekly basis. Number three, prayer will become more meaningful to you. Our growth groups are filled with prayer. We pray for the opening of the growth group. We pray for each other and spend a time in prayer for each other's needs. And so on a weekly basis, you have people who know your prayer requests and be able to pray for you personally as you pray for them personally. It's a wonderful way to not only pray for other people, but then to see the results of God's work in their life as you pray, and then you hear about what God is doing. Number four, you'll be able to handle stress under pressure better. What is that talking about? Well, it means that when you can share your struggles in life, when you can share what you're going through, it's a lot easier to handle pressure. And so this is a great way to be able to let the people of God pray for you, let them know what's going on in your life, and receive fellowship. Number five, you will develop leadership skills you never knew you had. We are putting people into leadership positions, not only in leading these growth groups, but leading within the growth groups, doing different things. And then our idea is that as leaders grow up in the growth groups, then those growth groups split off and they join. They create new growth groups, and we keep multiplying that way. So it's a wonderful way to grow in our faith, to go beyond non-leadership to a point where you're actually maybe leading a group or leading prayer or doing something in your group. You're contributing to a group of people worshiping the Lord. And number six, you'll be better able to reach out in love to those who need Christ. Part of growth groups, part of the DNA of growth groups is that we'll be outreaching, that we have outreach projects and things that the growth groups do together. And so we're developing those things all right now. And we're going to be giving a list of all the different opportunities that we would recommend the growth groups get involved in unless they have something of their own. So you'll take a look at, and it actually lists the five growth groups there. And some of them are targeting specific groups, so be aware of that. Some of them have not started yet. They have a start date. And what you're going to want to do is, if you want to join a growth group, go ahead and contact the leader of that group and talk to them about joining today. It would be a great time to go ahead and start doing that. I'm going to be announcing this for the next couple of Sundays and talking a little bit more about the need for growth groups, but I do want to just leave you with this. Growth groups are important because they take us to the next step in our worship of God. We come on Sunday mornings, and that's the first step. This is the time of worship. This is the time of corporate worship, where we're coming together in unity as the body of Christ. The next step is to join a group. Now, you don't have to join a growth group. You can join a Sunday school class or join a Bible study. They all basically do the same thing, and that is that it's a group who know you in a place where you can be discipled and grow in Christ. Because what we really want to do is we want to move beyond where we are in our Christian faith, right? We want to grow and increase in the image of Christ daily, and a growth group is designed to help us do just that, as well as the other discipleship groups we have going out the church. So I want to encourage everyone here, join a group in the church if you're not already involved in a church. I hope you're involved in this church. But if you're not involved in a group in the church, I really want to encourage you to think about joining some group this year. Take the next plunge. Take the next step in your Christian faith so that you can see what God is really going to do. And I believe he will do a lot in your life as you do so. Well, another announcement is that the All Church Birthday Potluck has been postponed, not canceled, but wait a few months and then we'll talk about it some more as that comes in. Now, on a personal note, I do want to mention that we talked about Pastor Alex and Carmen and the rough time they're going through last week. And I basically made the announcement and said, if anybody would like to give towards their car fund, if you remember that while they were in the hospital to take care of their baby who passed away, somebody stole their car while it was in the emergency section. And you have just been amazing as givers. And just that one Sunday, just announcing that, you gave $1,600 to that fund. So good job. And the missions committee is actually contributing some more money, so we'll be able to give them a good chunk. If you still would like to give to that, we're still taking giving, so I would encourage you for that as well. Anything else going on in the church, please read your bulletin or take a look at our website. There's a lot of information there that you can learn about what we have going on. Well, this is the time where we receive our offering. And we give to the Lord, we contribute to his kingdom and what he has going on in this world, because it's a delight in our hearts to give towards his mission. And after I pray, the kids are dismissed for children's church, and they're certainly welcome to stay, but we provide that for them as we teach them the word of God. So as we get prepared for that, why don't we bow our heads in the word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I pray this morning that you would capture our hearts, hold us close to you, and work your will in our lives. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you would minister to us, breathe your breath of life into our dead hearts. Help us, Lord, to not go through the motions this morning, but to come worshiping you in a fresh way, that we would be able to worship you in a way where we are awake. We are ready. We are alert. We are ready for the mission that you have for us today. We are ready to be encouraged, Lord. We have had a long week, and we pray that you would renew our spirits. And Lord, we know that the way we are renewed, the way we are lifted up as eagles fly, Lord, is that you do it by your Holy Spirit. And so we pray for your empowering this morning. We pray that everything this morning would be an encouragement from you to us, and that we would respond with worship and glorify your holy name that is due you. And so, Lord, as we do these things, I pray, Father, that you would work in our lives, create in us a clean heart, Lord, so that we may walk with you and our love for you would increase all the more. And we praise the name of Jesus. Amen.
During the offering this morning, we'd like to introduce this song. It's called All I Have is Christ. And we just want you to take a good look at the words. It's an amazing prayer and amazing thankfulness to our Lord and Savior.
I once was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the Jesus in that promise, joy and life, and led me to the grave. I had no hope that you would hold a rebel to your will. And if you had not loved me first, I would refuse you still. As I ran my hell-bound race, indifferent to the cost, you looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross. And I beheld God's love displayed. You suffered in my place. You bore the wrath reserved for me. Now all I know is grace. Alleluia. All I have is Christ. Alleluia. Jesus is my life. Alleluia. All I have. Lord, I would be yours alone and live so all might see the strength to follow your commands could never come from me. Oh, Father, use my ransom life in any way you choose and let my song forever be.
Jesus is my life, amen? Love those words. What a wonderful song. Well, I would invite you to open up your Bibles to the book of Mark, chapter 12. This morning we're talking about the whole truth. And fairly recently a spiritual leader in our nation said this, quote, "People are not on a search for truth. They're on a search for happiness." And there's a lot of truth to that. People are not necessarily on a search for truth. What people really want is to be happy. Now, we can come to the wrong conclusion about that and assume that then what we should be preaching about and teaching about and talking about is happiness versus truth. I think that we need to be talking about both. And I think we need to be talking about the order of both, and that is this: when we believe the truth, then we are made happy. And that, I think, is the whole truth. You see, every decision that we make of every day is based on what we believe to be true. Truth determines everything we do and we think. Not always true truth, but what we conceive and believe is truth is the basis by which we make our decisions. And God knows this because God is a God of truth. And God has said that there is something that sets us free. What sets us free? The truth. The truth will set you free. You see, happiness doesn't set you free. The truth sets you free to be happy. And it's believing a set of truth claims about Jesus Christ, not a good story about Jesus, which the book of Mark is a good story about Jesus, but it happens to be true. It happens to be a truth claim that these things are historical, that they actually happened. And the question is, do we believe these truths or do we not? And the answer to that question will determine our eternal life. So truth is vitally important to leading us to happiness. So we Christians are highly concerned with truth. We want to know the truth. We desire the truth. We long for truth. And the question that we're looking at this morning as we look at these stories of Jesus is, do we have the whole truth? You see, there's a difference between desiring truth and getting the whole truth. Sometimes we desire truth, but we only get partial truth. And we struggle with the parts that we don't get or understand or desire to follow. When we go to court and we testify, they say an interesting thing about truth because you're supposed to, you know, hold up your hand and you say, I will tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Well, if you think about that, why wouldn't it just stop at, I will tell the truth? Isn't that good enough? We're actually called to not only tell the truth, but we're supposed to tell the whole truth. Because here's the thing. A half-truth is a whole lie. Right? We can tell half-truths. We can tell you half the story and leave out this other half. And then it gives you a false conception of reality. And then it's not the whole truth, so it's not the absolute truth that God is dealing in. Half-truths are a whole lie. And so we as Christians are called by Christ to not just desire truth, but to desire the whole truth, the whole counsel of God, everything that He has called us to. In order to do that, we have to let God's truth reign over what we conceive truth to be. Did you catch that? In order to get the truth, in order to be those who really hold on to the truth of God, we have to release what we think of as truth, and the truth with maybe the way we were raised, or maybe the way we have been taught, maybe the things that we have learned, maybe the things that we have seen. We have to let God reign over all of those things and say, God, your truth determines reality because you are truth. You will never tell me a lie. So everything you say is true. And that includes the uncomfortable truths. And there's a lot, aren't there? There's a lot of uncomfortable truths. Perhaps that last song had some uncomfortable truths in it. I ran my hell-bound race. Doesn't feel very good to say. I don't have the power in myself to follow you, God. That's a very humble thing to say. But you take the whole truth, the whole counsel of God, and we got to say it's true. It's absolutely true. The scriptures tell us that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. If we want to live in wisdom, if we really want to embrace wisdom and knowledge and truth, then it all begins with the fear of the Lord. If we fear Him, if we look at Him and say, God, I trust you. You are a holy God, and what you say is true above everything else in my life, then we will begin on the road to wisdom. And in Isaiah 66:2, God says, all these things my hands have made. So all these things came to be, declares the Lord. But this is the one to whom I will look, he who is humble, he who is contrite in spirit, and he who trembles at my word. What does it mean to tremble at God's word? It means that when I approach God's truth, that I tremble with respect and awe of it, and I let it conform me. I let the word of God conform me and my understandings to his understandings, which are true. And so that's what he calls us to. But as we look at the text this morning, we're going to look at four stories. And in these four stories, we're going to see that the religious leaders of Israel were not prepared to do that. They were not prepared to look to God first to receive their wisdom. They were not prepared to trust Him completely. There were four different ways in which they inadequately sought truth. And so there are four warnings for us this morning, but four also pointers for us to be able to follow God and find the whole truth. So the first picture of inadequate truth in our passage this morning is popular truth. Popular truth. And that means that sometimes we determine truth by what's popular. We determine truth by what's the opinion of the day, and that determines what truth is. And perhaps you're thinking of our society and the different truth claims that are being put out there, and you've got some things in your mind. You realize that, why do we believe these things to be true? Well, because they're popular right now. They weren't popular 40 years ago, but they're popular right now. But now it's been we're being told that these are absolute things. Well, this is not new to Christianity. As a matter of fact, Jesus encountered this very thing. Let's take a look at this fascinating passage in verse 13. And we're just going to kind of walk through this story and look at popular opinion and what it means when you follow this. So this is the last week of Jesus' life. It's most likely Wednesday. He's only got two more days until he dies. And it's full court press upon Jesus by the religious leaders of Israel. This whole text is them pushing him and trying to get him to basically say something that will allow them to be able to arrest him. And so all of these are going to be tests of Jesus we're looking at this morning. Verse 13, and they sent to him some of the Pharisees and some of the Herodians to trap him in his talk. And they came and said to him, Teacher, we know that you are true and do not care about anyone's opinion, for you're not swayed by appearances, but truly teach the way of God. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Shall we pay them or should we not? The first thing we notice is that they're saying some really nice things about Jesus. And so that should cause us to question what they're saying, because they don't ever say nice things about Jesus, do they? The Pharisees? Not when they come as a group. And so what's going on here? What's going on here is that they're trying to butter up Jesus. They're trying to capture him in a trap, and they're buttering him up. But what's interesting is what they're actually saying is true. Notice what they say. They say, you are true, and you don't care about anyone's opinion. That's true, isn't it? You're not swayed by appearances. Ironically, what they said was absolutely true, though they were completely insincere. But they were buttering him up so that they could play on his pride, if he had any. They thought he could have pride. And so they tried to draw him out. And so we got to be careful about this approach. They say that gossip is what people say behind your back that they would never say to your face. Flattery is what people would say to your face that they'll never say behind your back. And so that's what they're doing here. They're telling him something to his face they would never say in their groups. They would never really believe this. But they're trying to draw him out. And we also notice that this is a strange group of people. We have Pharisees and Herodians coming together. Now, what we have to be able to see here is that the Pharisees and Herodians are on different sides of the aisle. The Pharisees are the religious teachers and theologians of Israel. And when it comes to politics, they always side with the nation of Israel. They believe that the Romans who are occupying the nation of Israel should leave, and that they should have the oppression of the Romans be thrown off, and they're going to support the people of Israel in self-governance. But the Herodians are those who support Herod, and Herod is the puppet king of Caesar. And so these Herodians, they are following Rome, they are allegiant to Rome, and they think that Rome is the way they should go. And so these are two competing groups, people who are actual enemies, who come together, and they both come to Jesus to ask this question. And why would they do that? Because it's a trap. They ask him this question, and whichever way he slices it, one side or the other, he will then be condemned, because one group will get him on this side and one group will get him on this side. So what's the question? Well, should we pay taxes to Caesar or not is the question. Well, the Pharisees said, no, you shouldn't pay taxes to Caesar. And the Herodians said, yes, because they believe in the civic authority of Caesar, and so you should. So whichever side he makes it, if he says that I should support Caesar by paying taxes, then the Pharisees are going to jump on him. And if he says, no, you shouldn't, then the Herodians are going to say, you're anti-government, you're anti-Caesar, you're anti-Rome, and then they would jump on him. And the real core of the controversy is that this was a specific temple tax that went to Caesar. And you could only pay it by a certain coin, and the coin was called a denarius. And on this denarius, there was a picture of Caesar, and there was a statement, a little phrase on that coin that said, chief priest. Now, what that meant by saying chief priest is that Caesar is a god. And so what the Pharisees didn't like about this paying this is they believed that actually if you took this tax and you paid it to Caesar, that you were actually worshiping a false god. And so they believed that it was false worship. And the Herodians didn't believe that at all. They just thought that they should be supporting Caesar. They should be paying those taxes. And so the Pharisees landed on this side and the Herodians landed on the other side. So what should Jesus do? And we shouldn't be surprised that he actually answers this question correctly and is not condemned by either side. Because it is true that Jesus doesn't care about anyone's opinion and that what he says is true, and he's going to blow their minds with the truth of his statement. Verse 15, but knowing their hypocrisy, what hypocrisy? That they came to flatter him and they said he was a great teacher and they said that he was true. He knew that they were being hypocritical, that they didn't really believe that. He says, why put me to the test? He says, why are you trying to catch me in a trick? Why are you trying to capture me? He knew what they were doing. Bring me a denarius and let me look at it. And they brought one, and he said to them, whose likeness and inscription is this? And they said to him, Caesar's. Jesus said to them, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And they marveled at him. They were blown away. They thought they had him in a trap. He could only choose one or the other. And he says, well, you've got to give to... He doesn't say both. What he says is, give to Caesar what is Caesar's and to God what is God's. In other words, what he's saying is biblically speaking, we have a responsibility to give to the authorities what they ask us to give them financially. In other words, pay your taxes, right? No matter how they spend our money, we're called to pay our taxes. We're called to give what the civil authorities ask us to give, because that's whose face is on the coinage, and that's who makes the money and who operates this whole system. And so, yes, the Bible says give the authority to the leaders of our nation because their authority is given by God. But then he ups the ante and he says, but give to God what you owe God. What do you owe God? Well, we owe God homage, worship, allegiance, service, obedience. Those are the things we owe God. So he says, not only pay to the civic authorities, but don't take away from God. Give him what we owe him, all the worship and praise and obedience and service that is due his name. And so they realized he had answered well, because he was saying, yes, give the authorities what you would, but don't worship them. Worship God and give him everything that you owe him. And so God, Jesus, answers this question very well. And he doesn't bow down to popular opinion. He doesn't bow down to having to choose between one group or the other. And don't we oftentimes feel like we have to choose between one group or the other when it comes to truth? Deciding on which group is more popular at the time, or which one is presenting more arguments that sound better and they sound more accurate? Let me ask you, at work or when you're at school, are you pressured to give in to the popular opinion of the day that actually is contrary to the Word of God? Have you ever changed your mind on an issue because the group at large believed it? Because there were so many people around you that just believed something, and so you compromised your belief in the Word of God because basically everyone else around you believes this thing to be true? Perhaps you're thinking of some specific issues right now that you know that everyone in your life does not believe this scriptural thing, and you're pressured to change your views and to adjust it to our modern times. Let's follow the example of Jesus Christ and not be swayed by popular opinion, and hold strongly to the truth of Christ and let that determine truth, not popular opinion. Well, there's a second inaccurate truth or inaccurate way of finding truth we see in this text, and that is seeking truth practically. Practical truth. Now, sometimes we determine truth by what sounds most reasonable to us, right? You see, you had the Pharisees and the Herodians come to Jesus, and so they struck out, and so we have somebody else up to bat. It's the Sadducees in verse 18. And Sadducees came to him who say that there is no resurrection, and they asked him a question. So these Sadducees are a totally different group of people. These are the ones who are leaders in the Sanhedrin. They are rulers in the Sanhedrin, but they have a different take than the Pharisees. The people of Israel generally followed the theology of the Pharisees, but the Sadducees were a totally different group. They were theological liberals, if you will. They didn't believe in a resurrection. They didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in the supernatural, and they did not believe in the afterlife. In that sense, they were annihilationalists. They just believed that when you're done, you're done. So they refused all of the spiritual elements that God presents to us, and they only accepted the first five books of the Bible as His Word. And so this was a very narrow-minded group of people. They weren't open to spiritual realities. They were not open to the things of God. What they said is, truth is determined by what is most reasonable to us. Only what we can feel and touch and understand, that is what we will believe. We don't believe the stuff about angels. We don't believe the stuff about the supernatural, the afterlife. We haven't seen any of it. We haven't experienced any of it. So therefore, we do not believe it. Is the spirit of the Pharisees alive and well today? It is. It is. Truth is often determined by what sounds most reasonable, what we can prove, what we can know for sure. If I can't see it or experience it, then it must not be true. And so they show him this ridiculous scenario, and they're trying to trap him again by saying, okay, if you really believe in a resurrection, what about this situation? Verse 19. Teacher, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies and leaves a wife but leaves no children, the man must take the widow and raise up offspring for his brother. That's true. There were seven brothers. The first took a wife, and when he died, left no offspring. The second took her and died, leaving no offspring, and the third likewise. And the seventh left no offspring. Last of all, the woman also died. In the resurrection, when they rise again, whose wife will she be? For the seven had her as wife. Now, in this story, if I were the seventh husband, I would begin to get nervous. It doesn't say that they died of natural causes. So this is kind of a crazy situation, right? Seven brothers all die, and then finally the wife dies, and they're asking, whose wife is she going to be? And the reason they're asking this question is because they believe that the idea of resurrection meant that you just, when you're resurrected, you continue on life in eternity just the same way you lived on earth. You'll still be married to the same spouse that you had on life, and you have your kids, and you just continue on with your family as you do now. And for them, that was absolutely ridiculous, because if you've been married multiple times, then who will your spouse be? You see the dilemma. They're saying the idea of resurrection is ridiculous, because if you continue on with your life as you have it now and you have multiple spouses, then whose spouse will you be for eternity? It doesn't make sense. They're trying to capture Jesus, and they're questioning the truth of God, because, of course, the Old Testament does teach about a resurrection. And Jesus shows them something, and that is that God's truth is not always reasonable to our finite minds. God's truth is not always something that is going to be reasonable to our finite minds. We have to remember, we are finite. There are things in this world we don't understand, we don't experience, and some things we have to take at God's word. Some things we have experienced, some things we have not. All of them are the truth of God. And so he challenges them, and he calls them out for two reasons. One is, he says, you don't know the scriptures. And two, you don't know the power of God. Notice what he says in verse 24. For Jesus said to them, is this not the reason you are wrong, because you know neither the scriptures nor the power of God? For when they rise from the dead, they neither marry or are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. This is a reference to their misunderstanding of the power of God. They don't believe really in the power of God to change us in a resurrection into a different type of nature than we have now, that our type of life will not be like a family life we had. He says, our life in the resurrection will be like the angels. The angels do not procreate, therefore they do not get married. They don't have to create a family to propagate their race. This is part of humanity here on earth. But in the resurrection, we will have no need for such thing. We will have no need for marriage. We will not live in families like we do now. We're going to have one big family, and God is our Father. He says, if you understood the power of God, you understand that God can do this. God will make it different than it is now, and He can also resurrect from the dead. But you also don't understand the scriptures. And then he actually quotes them a scripture from one of the only books that they actually believe in. He quotes from Exodus about the resurrection. Because we know that Isaiah and different books and Daniel, they talk about resurrection. But where are you going to get the talk about resurrection and the afterlife from the first five books of the Bible? We would all probably be hard-pressed to find something, but Jesus finds something immediately. This is how awesome Jesus is at argumentation. By the way, Jesus never lost an argument. Isn't that cool? Finally, they're just, at the end of the passage today, they're just going to give up. Be like, we cannot defeat him in argument. He is so truthful. Verse 26, and as for the dead being raised, have you not read in the book of Moses, in the passage about the bush, how God spoke to him saying, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob? He is not God of the dead, but of the living. You are quite wrong. In other words, he's saying, you don't even know the scriptures. And he's talking to the scriptural experts of Israel. It's like saying to a carpenter, you neither know about wood nor how to build a house. A construction worker doesn't want to hear that, right? But he's saying, you don't even know the scriptures. And he lists this scripture where God declares himself as the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob. And what Jesus is capitalizing here is that it's in the present tense, I am. In other words, it's not that I was the God of them, you know, who are now dead. They're still alive. And we actually know they're still alive, right? We know they're still alive because we know they're in heaven with God because it's in the present tense. And so he says, you don't really focus on the scriptures, do you? You really don't know the scriptures as you should. And so you've taken this belief that you have that you don't understand how the resurrection works, and then you've just thrown it all out. You don't know the scriptures. And so we likewise have to get to a point in our own lives where we realize that what sounds reasonable to our finite minds isn't always what is truthful. This last week I was playing with my little baby son, Brennan. Brennan is 1 year old, and we were playing around on the carpet, and he's gotten into this habit where he likes to close closet doors. But he likes to close them with his hand on the door itself because he can't reach the doorknob to close it. So he'll be crawling on the ground, and he'll grab the door, and he'll try to close it like this. And guess what gets stuck in the door? His hand, right? And his hand keeps, you know, and then he'll look at me and go, you know, he'll cry. And then he'll pull it open, then he'll do it again, you know. And finally, I have to go, buddy, remove your hand. And then I close the door, and he's going, but open it again. You know, he wants to keep going. So many times we try to close the door on truth, but our own hands get in the way, our own minds get in the way, our own understanding gets in the way. And we have to remove ourselves and let God close the door of truth. We have to let him be able to do it for us. And that means opening our minds and bowing down to God's truth and saying, God, I don't fully understand this truth, but I don't have to because I need you to show it to me. I need you to reveal it to me. The truth, my friends, is that we live in a spiritual world, and we can't see that world. And so whatever God tells us about it, we have to believe, we have to trust, because we can't see it, we can't touch it, and many times we can't even experience it. But that's like a lot of things in life, is it? If you really think about it, there's a lot of things we believe that we've never experienced. I have never seen the Eiffel Tower, yet I hear it exists. Anybody seen it? Oh, there's so many of you. I envy you. I haven't seen it, so I'll have to take your word for it that it exists, but I've only seen it in pictures. For all I know, it could be a 10-inch model that somebody keeps taking pictures of, right? I thought about this one time when I was flying in a jet plane, and I just love that point where you fly through the clouds, right? And it's always so cool because you just pass right through them like a vapor, right? And you fly up into the sky, and it can be the whole sky can be covered in clouds, and you rise above, and it's sunny, and it's beautiful, and you get to see the tops of the clouds. I never get over seeing tops of clouds. And what struck me one time about this truth is that as I was flying up on the tops of the clouds, you know, and it was just beautiful and sunny, I was soaking in the vitamin D, I realized, and so now I was thinking clearly, I realized that for hundreds and thousands of years, no one has seen the tops of the clouds. No one knew what was above them. Does that mean that there was nothing above there? Does that mean that they didn't exist, there was nothing above the top of the clouds that existed? No, it just means we had no capability of seeing it. But we now have the capability of seeing, and it's marvelous. But for the majority of human history, nobody has ever seen the tops of the clouds. Hopefully next time you fly, you'll think about this and be thankful. Because I just love that concept that there are things that we can't see and that don't seem reasonable that are true. And so God is showing us so much about a spiritual world that we want to trust in, including the resurrection. The third mistake we make in seeking truth is persnickety truth. And you say, Pastor, why is persnickety? Why the word persnickety? Well, I needed another P. Persnickety means too much emphasis on trivial or minor details. Sometimes when we seek truth, we get caught up on the minor details of truth, and we don't see the forest for the trees. We get focused on this little thing and this little thing, and God wants us to put the whole picture together of truth. And so sometimes we only determine it as different people debate and talk about specific issues. We let that distract us from the whole truth of God. We have a very interesting situation in verse 28 because now there's another person who comes to Jesus with a question. And one of the scribes came up. Now, this guy's a fascinating character because he seems to be sincere. But he has a real question of Jesus and says that, and he heard them disputing with one another. And seeing that he answered them well, asked him. So he saw how awesome Jesus was as an arguer and how truthful he was. I have a question that I've always wanted answered because this guy obviously has truth. And he asked, which commandment is the most important of all? Let's stop there for a moment. That's a loaded question. Because the scribes and the Pharisee used to spend hours trying to answer this question about which was the most superior truth, which was the superior commandment that described all the other commandments. And so they used to talk about these. And not only that, but they used to rate the different laws on a list of heavy and light laws. And heavier laws are the ones you really needed to obey heavily, and their light laws are the ones you had to obey lightly. And they were constantly moving and changing which laws were heavy and which ones were light and where they moved up and down on the list. It was like the stock market of laws, and they were constantly debating this issue. But they missed the big picture. And so it is today that there are so many different views on different issues. If you go into a Christian bookstore, you will see one book right next to another book written by different people who come at Christianity from totally different perspectives. And the question is, how do you choose which one? There are so many persnickety issues out there, so many side issues that people are bringing up and competing views. How do you determine truth when you come across Christians who are writing books with opposing viewpoints? How do you determine it? How do you know where truth is? How do you get to the heart of it? And this young man had the humility to go ask the source of truth, the number one question that they all had been asking, which is the greatest commandment. And Jesus actually answers him, and not only that, but this young man gets it. Take a look at what Jesus says. Jesus answered, "The most important is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength." He's quoting from Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 5. And he goes, you know what? I'll even throw in the second one. He only asked for the first. He goes, and the second is this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. That's from Leviticus 19:18. There is no other commandment greater than these. Wow. This issue that was constantly debated by different sides was cleared up immediately by Jesus. Notice Jesus didn't even hesitate. He asked the question and then Jesus immediately answers. The most important is this, love God. Second is this, love your neighbor. And in these two things, the whole law is summarized. Now the scribe gets it in verse 32, and the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher, you have truly said that he is one, and there is no other besides him, and to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding, with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is much more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." And so he basically says, I get it, because now you've illuminated to me the whole point of Scripture, because Scripture talks about loving God and loving neighbor, and especially talks about loving God and describes how doing worship in a rote way, in a way where we just show up and we do worship and we go through the motions is not what God is looking for. He's looking for love. He's looking for us to enter into a loving relationship with him. And this man gets it from the scriptures. That's why he's saying this about the sacrifice. He's saying, I get it, that it's more important than the offerings of sacrifice. I've read that in scripture. David says that. Other people say this in the Old Testament. Verse 34, and when Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. And after that, no one dared to ask him any more questions. Case closed. We're done. We can't defeat this guy. He is the source of truth. I'd like to think that this young man found salvation in Christ. I'd like to think that he'll be in heaven with us someday. He seems to be a real truth seeker. And I think that this is a good picture for us, and that is this. There may be issues that are debated by scholars. There may be issues that seem to have no answer. But this young man found the answer, and the reason he found the answer was because he came to the source of truth, Jesus Christ, in what appears to be an act of faith and openness to his truth, and he accepted it. And so here's what I would say to you. If you have faith in Christ and are open to his word, I believe that you can understand things that even scholars don't get. Things that may seem completely unable to be discerned, indiscernible, I believe that if you walk by faith in Christ and you study his word, then he will lead you to truth. Jesus is still the source of truth, and his truth is in this word. A lot of times we get caught up in our theological systems. But let me explain to you this, that theological systems are a great servant, but they're a lousy master. The word of God must always supersede theological systems and the endless debates of theological issues. The word of God must always reign supreme and have the authority over any system that we create. Which leads us to our last inadequate way of seeking truth, and that is this, partial truth. Partial truth is not the whole truth. We have to be open to the whole counsel of God, not the part of the counsel of God. Verse 35, and as Jesus taught in the temple, he said, how can the scribes say that Christ is the son of David? David himself and the Holy Spirit declared, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. David himself calls him Lord, so how is he his son? And the great throng heard him gladly. You see, what Jesus is saying here is this, that the scribes and the Pharisees talk about the Christ, that is the Messiah. They tell us about this, the Messiah, and they say that he is the son of David, but they have not contended with Psalm 110:1. And Psalm 110:1 is what Jesus quotes here. And he says, they describe to you that the Messiah is the son of David, but why do they not contend with this concept as David wrote Psalm 110 about what he said in this one verse? Notice what he says. The Lord said to my Lord. Who's the first Lord? It's God the Father. Who's the second Lord? The Messiah. Who's writing this? David. The Lord said to my Lord, is what David is saying, sit at my right hand, because that's where the Messiah goes, at God's right hand, as the Father's right hand, until I put your enemies under your feet. That is the Messiah's enemies under his feet. So his question is, why does David call the Messiah Lord? Adonai. Because he's God. So how can he be his son? You see, they hadn't contended with the whole counsel of God. They had said, yes, the Messiah is the son of God, but they haven't realized that he is in the line of David, but he is also God. And so he brings out here, and he gets to the point of saying, you guys got to contend with this, that the Messiah is God, and it says so in Scripture. It says so in Psalm 110:1, and you need to contend with that. And the great throng heard him gladly. Their minds are blown because he's finally opening up the scriptures to them. And he's still opening up the scriptures to us today. We have to believe in the whole truth of God. We can't take partial truth. We can't be like the guy who said, Lord, I want to open up my Bible, and whatever verse I put my finger on, I want you to speak to me today. I want this to be my truth. And he opened up the Bible, and he put his finger on the verse. It says, and Judas went and hung himself. He said, oh, wait, Lord, no, that's not for me today. So then he flipped to another passage, and he opened up his Bible. He let it drop where it is. He put his finger down, and he pointed to the scripture that says, you go and do likewise. No, that can't be what the Lord has for me. And then he put his Bible back together and he let it drop open and he put his finger down one more time to the scripture that says, whatever you do, do quickly. We have to take the whole counsel of God, right? We have to take everything that he teaches us. We have to let Scripture interpret Scripture and take everything together, not partial truth, but whole truth. We can't be the ones who put on a display of truth but don't actually know it. And that's exactly what the scribes and Pharisees did. Take a look at verse 38. Here's the indictment of this group of people. This is what it means to be those who teach truth but don't really hold to it. And in his teaching, he said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and like greetings in the marketplaces and have the best seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at feasts, who devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation." We don't want to be like them who are putting on a show of truth. We want to actually possess the truth. We want to actually be people of truth, be people who study the Word and study the things of Christ, are dependent upon the Holy Spirit to illuminate to us, and to be those who talk together about the truth and encourage each other with the truth of God, but to hold it above all else. This takes my mind back to 1521. It was a good year. 1521, in Germany, a young Augustinian monk was standing in the city of Worms, and he was in a council where people were questioning his beliefs. The emperor of the Holy Roman Empire was there, and the Roman Catholic Church was coming down on him because he had wrote some things against them that they believed were heresy. And if you think about what he said, he had these writings, and he got to this point where he wrote against the beliefs of the religious groups of the time because he started reading his Bible. One day he just started reading the Scripture, and he realized that his Bible was saying different things than the things that he was being taught. And he realized that it wasn't the Pope who was the one who had the keys to the doors of heaven. He realized that it was Jesus Christ who had the keys. He was the only mediator. And therefore, we are all priests. And therefore, we don't need a mediator to get to heaven. And then he went even further and kept reading his Bible, and he got to the book of Romans, and he taught through the book of Psalms in the school that he was a teacher. And as he looked at the Scriptures, he realized that the only way to receive righteousness is by faith, not by works. And so he came to the conclusion through Scripture that salvation is by grace alone, not by works. It is by faith alone, not by mediation of someone else. And it is by Christ alone, not by some individual. Salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. And the reason he came to that conclusion was he believed in the Word of God alone. That the Word of God alone is the one that determines truth. And so as he stood there trembling before this body, knowing that if he did not recant of his teachings, the ones I just described, then he would probably be killed for his faith. So he realized that his stand for truth was going to cost him his life. And I want to read to you what he said as they were getting ready to make their final decision on his life. He says, "Unless I am convinced by the testimony of the Scriptures or by clear reason, for I do not trust either in the Pope or in councils alone, since it is well known that they have often erred and contradicted themselves. I am bound by the Scriptures I have quoted, and my conscience is captive to the Word of God. I cannot and I will not recant anything, since it is neither safe nor right to go against conscience. May God help me. Amen." You know who I'm talking about, right? Martin Luther. This was the beginning of the Protestant Reformation. They were protesting the leaving of Scripture, and they were reforming the church to believe in the Scripture, and they developed the idea of sola scriptura, which in Latin means Scripture alone determines what we believe. And we today stand on the shoulders of giants. And so we're called to the same thing. We're called to be those who seek the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help us, God. Amen? Would you bow with me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we pray that we would be those who really seek your word, who are open to what you have to say, Lord, that we have a willingness and an openness to your determination for us, what you say reality is and what you say is beyond the grave. I pray, Father, that we would receive it with faith, knowing that you have always proved yourself true. You have never led us astray. You have never been false. You are truth, Father, and I pray that as we spend time with you, that that truth would rub off on us. And I pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Now is the time in our service where we get to respond as a body in unity as we sing praises to our God. So the songs that we pick are a chance for us together to sing in thankfulness and reflection of what we've just heard. So would you stand with us as we sing? We're going to start with your name. Only in Jesus' name do we find truth and salvation. Your name.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. And Jesus, in your name we pray, come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name.
Amen. Only in the name of Christ. This next one is the one we introduced during offering. All I have is Christ.
I once was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way. The sin that promised joy and life had led me to the grave. I had no hope that you would own a rebel to your will. And if you had not loved me first, I would refuse you still. I ran my hell-bound race, indifferent to the cost. You looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross. And I beheld God's love displayed. You suffered in my place. You bore the wrath reserved for me. Now all I know, hallelujah, all I have is Christ. Hallelujah, Jesus is my life. Hallelujah, all I have is Christ. Hallelujah. would be yours alone, and live so all might see the strength to follow your commands could never come from me. Oh, Father, use my ransom life in any way you choose, and let my song forever be my only boast is you. Alleluia, all I have is Christ. Alleluia, Jesus is my life. Alleluia, all I have is Christ. Alleluia, Jesus is my life. Alleluia, all I have is Christ. Alleluia, Jesus is my life.
Amen. Amen. We bow down. You are Lord of creation and Lord of my life.
You are Lord of creation and Lord of my life, Lord of the land and the sea. You are Lord of the heavens before there was time. Lord of all, Lord, you will be. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. Lord of all, Lord, you will be. You are King of creation and King of my life, King of the land and the sea. You were King of the heavens before there was time. King of all kings you will be. We bow down and we hail you the King. We bow down and we crown you the King. We bow down and we crown you the King. King of all kings you will be. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. We bow down and we worship you, Lord. Lord of all, Lord, you will be. Lord of all, Lord, you will be.
Amen. We're going to finish with Holy, Holy, Holy. Amen.
Holy, holy, holy.
Though the darkness hide thee, though
Father, what a gift you've given us in your word, in the truth that we can cling to. When everything else around us is changing, you are unchanging, all-powerful, all-loving, forgiving God. Lord, thank you for that this morning, that we've found it in your word, that we find it in your son, and that we can walk with that in our lives. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for coming to worship with us. Please stick around for Sunday school. You are dismissed.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty,
all thy works.
All thy works shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, 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 merciful.